The 26th of October, 1967. The Hall of Mirrors in the Gulistan Palace in Tehran. The Shah of Iran places a blazing crown studded with regal jewels on the head of his queen and proclaims her Empress of Iran. A historical day for Iran and a momentous one in the life of Farah Pahlavi. In the 2,500-year history of Iran, Farah Pahlavi is the first woman to be so singularly honored. The thousands of Iranians who jammed the streets of Tehran went wild with joy and pride. Empress was given the title of Shahbanou, meaning the Shah's consort. Farah Diba, an unknown architecture student, had come a long way.
In October of 1967, Your Majesty was crowned as the Empress of Iran. In the 2,500 years history of Iran, Your Majesty is the first woman to be so singularly honored. How does it feel to be Empress of Iran at this exciting period in the history of Iran?
I think that when my husband crowned me the Empress of Iran, it was not a personal matter only. He wanted by that symbolically honor all the women of Iran. And for that reason, I was very proud and happy, not only for myself, but as a symbol, as the representative of women of our country, which for years have been put aside any participation in the life of the country. I feel that I am more responsible and I have more duties, and I am happy to be able to be at a position to help in any ways I can my country and my people. For that, I wanted to tell you a poem of Rabindranath Tagore, which is your famous poet. He says that I slept and I dreamed that life was joy. I awoke and saw that life was duty. I acted and behold, duty was joy.
The Shahbanu's duties are manifold. She is to be seen more often traveling through the villages of Iran than at glittering openings and royal gatherings. Every year, she takes a prolonged trip through the far-flung villages of Iran, talking to the people, finding out their problems and needs, and helping wherever she can. And they come by the thousands, the poor and the illiterate, the oppressed and the have-nots, to see, to talk to, and to pay homage to an empress who has done and is doing so much for their social upliftment. These villagers and nomads who flock to see their empress are to a great extent illiterate and poor. And in spite of the millions of oil dollars flowing into Iran, and in spite of the Shah's white revolution, their living conditions have not shown much significant improvement. The curse of all developing countries, a corrupt bureaucracy that seldom functions, is one of the great hindrances to progress in Iran. And not even the Shah, with his far-reaching revolutionary programs, has succeeded in eradicating this illness from the Iranian society. The Shahbanu tries to cut through the labyrinth of bureaucracy, and she is the one who is closest to the people, and she gets things done. There have been numerous examples where she was able to help the needy, despite the ignorance and arrogance of the Iranian bureaucrats. Iran, economically and militarily one of the strongest nations on the Persian Gulf, is today on the threshold of a new era. Oil has brought wealth, and with it, a lot of problems that need solutions. The nation is being catapulted from the Middle Ages right into the 21st century and is in danger of losing its identity and forgetting its past cultural heritage. No one is more aware of these problems than the Shah and his young empress. The Shah, who nurtures dreams of being Iran's greatest emperor and who wants to go down in history on a par with great predecessors like Cyrus Darius and Xerxes, is more concerned with the political developments and international relations. It's a sign of his confidence in the empress that he has delegated her to look after the social and cultural development of Iran. And the empress has done her job with skill, energy, and dedication. Today, Farah Pahlavi is respected and loved by all Iranians, and some people say even more than the Shah. The only daughter of an Iranian army officer, Farah Diba was born in Tehran on the 14th of October, 1938. She lost her father at an early age, and her mother, Mrs. Farida Diba, looked after the education of her young daughter. After her schooling in Tehran, she was sent to Paris for higher studies, where she devoted herself to the study of architecture. While still a student in Paris, she was introduced to the Shah. On the 21st of December, 1959, she married the Shah in a glittering wedding ceremony. In accordance with Persian tradition, Farah twice remained silent when asked if she would marry the Shah. The third time, she said, "Bali," meaning yes, and thus became the wife of the most powerful monarch in the world and queen of Iran. In his book, Mission for My Country, the Shah has written, "It was my desire to find a wife who not only would present me with a son, but who would be a friend and a companion." The Shah, until then without a male heir to the throne and his two previous marriages, did not have to wait long to see the fulfillment of his desires. On the 31st of August, 1960, the young queen gave birth to Prince Reza Cyrus Pahlavi, who thus became heir to the throne. Three more children followed, Princess Farnaz, Prince Ali Reza, and Princess Leila. In the meantime, the young queen had established herself as a permanent pillar of the Pahlavi dynasty. She blended easily into the royal family and wisely kept clear of the intrigues that are so common in any royal court. Her good nature and simplicity endeared her to the other members of the royal family, and they welcomed her with open arms. She was not only wife, mother, and empress, but also regent, which meant that she would ascend the throne should anything happen to the Shah before the crown prince reaches the age of 20. The young empress devoted a large amount of her time to the social and cultural development of Iran. To preserve the age-old cultural heritage of Iran is one of Her Majesty's pet projects. Here she is seen with the Shah visiting the Pahlavi Museum, and laying the foundation to a new annex which will house the art treasures of the Pahlavi dynasty. Today, Iran is a power to reckon with on the international scene. Do the Shah and the Shahbanu dream of restoring Iran to its past cultural glory?
It is very important for both of us, and my husband has always taken a great interest in the culture and art of this country, in its civilization, in its past history. And for me, it is even more because I am more involved in that field directly. I think it is very important that when we make a progress materially or economically or military, to have, to keep our national identity. For me, it's very important to keep our own culture, our best tradition.
To preserve the best of the past and find a suitable synthesis with the present, that is the aim that the Empress constantly follows. She is the patron or chairman of more than 25 cultural and social foundations. Here, she is presiding over a meeting of the Pahlavi Foundation. This organization, for example, promotes art and artists and also maintains over 50 orphanages all over the country. The members of the board include writers and artists, sculptors and painters, filmmakers and social workers. In spite of her heavy schedule, the Empress takes the time to be personally informed of the progress of the different activities. She's not content to be just a figurehead, and she is personally involved in all the decisions taken by the foundation. Empress Farah has given both her patronage and her time to the cultural regeneration and stimulation of contemporary arts in Iran. Here, she pays a visit to Iran Basta, a museum that displays old and new archaeological finds. Under the auspices of this museum, excavations are carried out all over Iran to find and preserve the archaeological treasures buried deep beneath the soil. Cooperation with foreign excavation teams and educational institutions has been accompanied by donations to foreign universities to boost Persian studies there. The Empress takes a personal interest in the progress of this museum, and whenever new finds are discovered, she makes it a point to come and see them and get first-hand information about these newfound objects out of Iran's rich past. The aim of another foundation under the auspices of Her Majesty is to find and promote talents in the field of art, music, literature, and sculpture. Talent scouts travel through the distant villages of Iran looking for gifted youngsters. These young Iranians, whose talents would otherwise go unnoticed, are carefully picked, and each one receives a scholarship personally from the hands of the Empress in the Palace of Tehran. The scholarship enables them to study and perfect their skills. Exceptionally talented youngsters are later sent abroad for higher education and training.
Now, Your Majesty is constantly on the move. The last few days that we've been here, you've been opening museums, visiting different functions and so on. What motivates Your Majesty to be constantly on the move? You could have quite an easy life, but you have, of your own free will, taken on all these jobs, if I may call them. What is it that motivates Your Majesty?
I think that I feel that it is my duty and my responsibility to do so, being in this position. And also that personally, I feel that I want to be able to help in any field I can. Of course, sometimes I say that I wish I had less work and I could have much leisure time for my own interests, to have much more time with my children. But I wouldn't be able to just sit and relax and put myself aside the problems of my own country and also the problems of the world. I think that people are anyway in my country more and more involved, and they should more and more participate. And I feel that at the same time, the way I act is a way that I want our women to act. And if I go to many places, if I go to many visits, it is useful for that organization or that those subjects. And since God has given me this possibility of being useful, why not use it as long as I have the energy?
The Empress has in the past shown a remarkable amount of energy. She's not only a super minister of art and culture, she is at the same time a kind of special ambassador for the Shah. He has sent his Empress on goodwill tours all over the world. Here, the Empress pays a visit to China, where she met the late Prime Minister Zhou Enlai. The Chinese communists received the Empress with great warmth. These visits serve not only to spread goodwill for Iran in the world, but are at the same time good political training for an empress who is the official regent of Iran. In the past years since she became empress, she has visited every major country in the world.
Majesty is the Empress of Iran, but how much power do you really have? Do you have to get okay on all the decisions from His Majesty, or are there possibilities where you can decide on your own?
Well, there are many subjects that I have to talk with my husband and ask his opinion or ask his okay. But there are many other subjects that I am personally involved to, and I can act by my own. But I always believe in dialogue and discussion, and I see our ministers, I see our prime minister once a week, and we talk if there is a subject which can change a whole view or a whole work. Otherwise, in as I told you, in many other organizations that I'm president of, it's my responsibility.
Has the Shahinsha ever said no to any of your projects?
I have to remember, he has said maybe many times no to some of my point of views, or because we have a very open discussion in different subjects. But whatever I do anyway, it's in the way that His Majesty has set for this country. It's in the philosophy of our revolution, what we call the revolution of the Shah and people. So whatever I try to do, it's for the good of the country. And now that you ask me, I can't say which subject, because I don't remember, which proves that I have had little nose.
That's nice, thank you. Now, should anything happen to His Majesty, you, before the Crown Prince would be 21 years of age, Your Majesty would be automatically the ruler of Iran. It's a very great responsibility. How exactly does Your Majesty prepare yourself for this? Does Your Majesty sit in cabinet meetings? Do you get into the political implications of the country? How exactly is this preparation going on?
Well, I hope, I pray God that this will never happen. But otherwise, I have been each year more and more involved in what is happening in my country, socially, culturally, or politically, without being maybe directly or acting directly involved in politics. But whatever one does in a country, it has the political side anyway, in each field, whether social, cultural, or educational. By being more involved, and as I told you, I have regular meetings with our Prime Minister and with our ministers, and talks with my husband, and my husband has set a program for me to meet different officials, whether in politics, government, or military, to have meetings with me and with my son, to prepare and to explain in different subjects. And my husband has written, as he say, his political will. He has gathered the people who should be gathered and has talked to them about the way he wants this country to be when he's not alive one day. And in our country, as you see, we are getting more and more, we are getting our people to participate in a political life through the party. So my husband, what he wants is to have to give more and more responsibility to people themselves.
Now let's talk about a bit about women's liberation and emancipation. Would Your Majesty say that the women of Iran have been really liberated?
Well, there has been tremendous changes in the life of women of Iran. The most fundamental changes that should happen. First of all, the equal rights that was given to Iranian women almost 13 years ago. The right to vote, the right to be elected. Right. The problems of polygamy. The problem of divorce, the problem of who takes care of the children, and many other laws, which are, I think, very important, and it has happened only in a period of 13 years. Of course, there are some little laws.
For example, an Iranian woman cannot leave Iran,
yes,
without her husband's permission.
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes. So this is a problem because the public opinion is that it can destroy the families, it could create difficulties between a husband and wife. I don't believe so. But I don't believe either that this is a very important subject yet. The most important laws have been changed. But there are things like that. There are other things also that since we have a ministry for women's affair and it's a lady, and she's trying to study the different laws to make the little changes, to put one word before the other or vice versa in a law, which can change a lot. But we are a Muslim country, we are a traditional country, many changes have been done, and we have to see what is priority for us. Instead of trying only for prestige, only for the rest of the Western world to say that we have done this or that.
Your Majesty, the question was about the opposition in Iran and outside Iran to the Shahanshah's rule in Iran. There have been demonstrations in Germany, there have been demonstrations in the United States. How would you explain these demonstrations?
Well, first of all, I have to say, who doesn't have demonstration in any system or any political regime? It's normal that young people have their own point of views, or it's mostly the young people. They have their views about progress, about life, about humanity, and because they are not as involved and as they want to in any country, so the reaction becomes as a demonstration in the streets. It's not, I say it's normal in a way, but it's not normal now with the situation which exists in the whole world, because it's mixing with terrorism, it's mixing with anarchism and act of vandalism, which one wonders why it is happening. About our own country, I must say that what is happening in Iran, the progress in Iran, in every field, it's not for the best of different groups. I don't name any special group, but many. Iran is a rich country because of its oil.
Well, I guess I can name the groups. That's the people who own most of the land, the spiritual leaders, the Shahanshah spoke to me about. These are probably the people who are against these reforms.
Some, but these are not important. I was in my mind, I was talking about the demonstration outside of Iran.
I see.
There are different groups who take care of the young Iranian who go outside. Some of them, they have their own point of views. I can't say that they all have been brainwashed, but some are brainwashed and some are paid, unfortunately. They have become professional demonstrators because that, as I told you, Iran is rich and Iran has an important strategic position. For many years, nobody knew Iran or who was ruling it and what is happening. Today, Iran has its place in the world, had its word in the world. So it doesn't make everybody happy. They are trying to attack Iran in each way they can. And what another saying in Iranian, a Persian says that they can fish out of troubled water. The more troubled it is, the more fish anybody can get out of it. It's a tasty piece of cake, Iran, and it is for us also, so we do not want to give it away. Of course, there are problems in our country. We know it ourselves. There are many things has been changed. Iran has, out of the Middle Ages, has entered the 20th century. There has been many laws in our own country for the favor of the majority of our people, which I can really say that they have not been able to have those laws in even socialistic countries. But because these young people who grow from little villages of Iran, little small towns of Iran, suddenly in Europe, in America, it's such a shock, such a change, that the reaction will be, why aren't we like that? They cannot realize that there has been 200 years of hard working in the States to reach what they are, or in Europe or anywhere else. They have passed centuries and hard work to have what they have today. So even that is a shock for them. And they say, why aren't we like that? And they see maybe the beginning, all the positive side of the materialistic side of progress. The problems that each country has, they don't see it. For us, for myself, even sometimes I have deceptions, I can get angry, there are things which go wrong, but it needs time and it needs education of changing a sort of mentality of a country to get the participation of people. It's not only one or two people who are ruling the country, there are many people involved and they are not all thinking the same way. So there are problems. But what our reaction is, or my reaction is to try to do something about it, to try to hard work, to try to find a way for it.
بچه ها میخواستم بگم که چرا امروز شما رو جمع کردیم اینجا. دیروز که من رد میشدم برای بازدید از حارسابا.
Farah Pahlavi is always looking for ways and means to bring about change. Unlike many other first ladies who just preach about the lot of the downtrodden and about the need for social change and then sit back and do nothing, Farah Pahlavi is a woman of action. Here she joins the villagers in the ecological campaign to keep Iran clean and beautiful. She's constantly trying to make the Iranians feel proud of their ancient culture and their breathtaking landscapes. One of Farah Pahlavi's early interests was, and still is, the education of children and young adults. Well aware of the fact that the children of today are the builders of tomorrow's Iran, she has founded the Institute for the Intellectual Development of Children and Young Adults. Its principal goal is to promote the intellectual, artistic, and creative aspects of children's growth. The Institute has established a chain of libraries all over Iran where the children can get together, read books, play, paint, and practice music and singing. Every year, a children's film festival is also organized by the Institute. Director of this children's foundation is Lili Amir Arjumand, a former classmate of the Empress. Incidentally, this is one of the very few organizations in Iran that functions smoothly without corruption and bureaucratic delays.
Your Majesty, we are here high up in the clouds, in the skies. You are on your way to Jordan. Would you just tell me in short what the objectives of your trip to Jordan are?
This trip is a private trip and I'm happy to go. It coincides with the birthday of His Majesty King Hussein. And at the same time, there will be the inauguration of a center for children. That was a gift from Iranian children to Jordanian children. It's a center for library and cultural activities. And it's going to be the inauguration of that.
The Empress had invited the author and his team to accompany her on this trip to Jordan. Farah Pahlavi is a close personal friend of the late Queen Aliyah of Jordan. Iran has had a special relationship with Jordan for many years. Both countries are monarchies, and the Shah has always admired the courage and tenacity of King Hussein. King Hussein, on the other hand, is grateful for the economic and military support that the Shah gives to his country. The visit coincided with the birthday of King Hussein, and to mark the occasion, a children's center was opened in Amman. This center, a gift to the children of Jordan from Iran, has all the facilities that the children's centers of Iran have. The center was officially opened by the Empress in the presence of King Hussein and Queen Aliyah. Present at the ceremony were also ex-King Constantine of Greece with his queen, Anne-Marie. Queen Aliyah of Jordan, who died a few months later in a tragic accident, had this to say about her friend, the Empress of Iran.
Your Majesty, you are a personal friend of the Shahbanu of Iran, and I think your friendship has been for a couple of years. Could you tell me a little about the basis of this friendship and your characterization of the Shahbanu of Iran?
Well, when I first got married, I visited Iran and I met the Shahbanu, and I think basically we found we have so much in common. And talking of problems, of what we have to do, what has to be done, and I think that with her experience and for the years that she's been married, she has taught me a lot, and I think that's how it started. And we got along, and ever since, she's like a sister to me, and our friendship has grown, and I hope it will stay and strengthen, as she's a wonderful lady. She works very hard, and she's my example, and I hope to follow her footsteps to be able to carry our work and what she has done to do for my country.
The Empress in her private office in the Niavran Palace in Tehran. In spite of the objections of her private secretary, Mr. Hoveda, the Empress let us film her at her desk. This was the first time that a television crew was allowed into her private office. This is Her Majesty's private retreat, where she can relax, listen to her favorite music, either ancient Persian or Bach and Beethoven, go through her private correspondence, browse through books and albums. Her official duties take up much of her time, and it's seldom that she can allow herself the luxury of the peace and solitude in her private office. Seeing her sitting on the floor, looking through clippings and albums of her husband and children, one is reminded more of a wife and mother than an empress. And it's her simplicity and human touch that have endeared her to the millions of Iranians.
Your Majesty, now I would like to come to Your Majesty as a private person. You can only answer these questions if Your Majesty wishes. The transition from a happy-go-lucky teenager to being the Queen of Iran, the Empress of Iran, wasn't this very tough, very difficult? How was it?
In those days, of course, it was such a change, and I think I was a little bit in the clouds and not knowing what's happening to me. It's now that I see the difficulties more and more each year, because, you know, to get involved in different activities, it took me years. Few years in the beginning to know the problems of my country, to find the ways how to solve it and to get more and more involved. And of course, you know, when you're young, you have some ideals, and but your scope is not, anyway, mine was not so wide. It was few changes and one thing, it can solve the whole problem. Now I am more aware of what is happening. What I miss now is really, it's happening now. I don't know whether it's I'm getting older or what, but it's, you know, that freedom one has when you're nobody. To just be able to go in the streets, to have the contact with the ordinary life, and not to be always surrounded by people, by your position, by bodyguards. And that it's becoming sometimes, it's the only feeling that I have which annoys me. Of course, I can manage maybe to get away sometimes. I have organized, I have to do it because it has become an obsession for me. Sometimes I take a car, but I have, of course, the security behind me to go and drive outside, or I go in the park in front of the palace, and people sometimes know me, but I would, I have to do it. I would like to go in the streets really incognito. It's difficult if I get disguised, because if people recognize me, it's not proper. If I don't, then they recognize me and they gather. But I will manage to do it, because this is one has this, after a while, a sense of
being in a golden cage.
Yes.
Your Majesty.
When they were telling me this in the beginning of my wedding, I didn't realize it, but I realize it more now.
Your Majesty, could you describe Your Majesty's feelings when you met His Majesty for the first time?
Well, the first time I met him in person was in Paris when I was as a student and presented to him. I had always a lot of devotion and respect and love for the king, without any question, because it was my king and I loved him. I was very impressed by the tone of his voice and the look in his eyes, which was very gentle and very profound.
Could one say that it was kind of love at first sight?
No, in those days he didn't remember me then. I was just a student as the others presented. Then we met, of course, in Tehran at Princess Shahnaz, who's my husband's first daughter. And we talked very simply. And then little by little, the story started.
How was Your Majesty's feelings when he first asked for your hand in marriage?
Well, you know, when we first met, I must say that when I knew that I was going to meet him, my heart was beating. I thought I could hear it. And then he has a very nice contact, so I calmed down and we talked about different subjects. But after we met for a while, I think that I was in a way expecting it. Mm-hmm. And I was, when he asked me, he said that whether I would like to share his life as a wife and also as someone who will be next to him to have responsibilities in the country. And I was also seeing my life in that way. It was not only my private life, but I was also feeling that I will be responsible. I would try to do something for my people.
To be wife, mother, and empress is a full-time job, and Farah Pahlavi is often saddened by the fact that she has so little time to spend with her children. One occasion she never misses, however, is the football match, when the Crown Prince Reza and his schoolmates play against a local school. Like any mother, she is proud of her children, and when the Crown Prince, who incidentally, like his father, is a very good sportsman, scored a goal, she joined the chorus of the happy school children in cheering and clapping. The author had seldom seen the Empress so relaxed and happy as on this afternoon.
Two years.
Weekend, and the children are off on a holiday to the island of Kish, where the royal family has a holiday retreat. Their parents cannot accompany them because of official duties in Tehran. The Empress brings them to the helicopter, and like any mother, she gives them last-minute advice and instructions. Each child has its own helicopter because of security reasons and as a safeguard against unforeseen accidents. In the interviews with the author, the Empress readily admitted that, like other parents all over the world, she too has problems with the education of her children. The mother is more inclined to leniency, and the father is for strict education. The Shah is especially concerned about the education of the Crown Prince, who is now 17. He is being educated in a special school in Iran to prepare him for his future duties. Farah Pahlavi herself had a very strict mother, and her education was far from lenient. Her mother, Mrs. Farideh Diba, lives today in her own palace in Tehran. How was the young Farah educated? Was the mother very strict with her daughter? What a question. I was a strict mother, but my education has shown good results. It was my intention to make my daughter an intellectually and morally responsible person, and I think I've succeeded.
خوشبختانه چیزی که منو راضی تر زندگی کرده بود همون جدیت دخترم بود در درس و اخلاق به یقین هر مادری هر پدری به خصوص بچه یک دونه است خیلی مواظبه میخواد که اون بچه خیلی خوب تربیت بشه و خیلی خوب درس بخونه من خواسته هاشو به جا می آوردم خواسته های بچگیشو دوران کودکیشو ولی در این حال مادر جدی بودم متاسفانه با الان فکر می کنم خیلی زیاد جدی بودم بله.
Your daughter, the Empress, is a very active woman. She's constantly on the move, and she's chosen a hectic life, although she could lead an easy life if she wanted to. What motivates your daughter? I think God has granted her many qualities, and she has developed these qualities to the full. She was very young at the time of her marriage, but the Shah's experience and wisdom have helped her to develop into a mature woman.
نداشتم که بچه دومی داشته باشم خیلی براش دقیق بودم خب هر بچه ای از هوش و ذکاوتش استفاده میکنه و خب خوب بزرگ میشه و میتونه و خیلی هم جوان بود عروسی کرد با شاه ما که انقدر پادشاه بلند فکری داریم در مکتب ایشونم خوب بار آمدن
Good thoughts, good words, good deeds was the motto on which Iran's age-old spiritual development was founded. The great Persian poets Hafez and Sadi emphasized the importance of love for humanity. The Empress of Iran lives according to this motto, and she is an example to all her countrymen. International recognition for her services to humanity have come from abroad, too. Among others, an award from the United Nations and the Golden Mercury Award from Italy. Thank you. The heritage of Persepolis and Shiraz, of Hafez and Saadi, of the miniature painters and the builders of the most beautiful mosques in the East, of a 2,500-year-old civilization that was founded on human values, is safe in the hands of Farah Pahlavi, Shahbanu of Iran.
Farah Pahlavi, empress of the mightiest nation on the Persian Gulf, is indeed a remarkable woman. I know of no other first lady in the world today who has done and is doing so much for her country. She's involved in the political affairs of her country. She has contributed a great deal to the social betterment of the poor and the downtrodden, of women and children. But I think her greatest contribution is to the centuries-old cultural heritage of Iran. She has made Iranians feel proud of their country and their culture. On the wall, behind the desk of Her Imperial Majesty in her private office, there is a quotation from an unknown poet. Grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the intelligence to tell the difference. This appears to be the guiding principle of the Empress of Iran. If a woman can be the empress of a mighty nation and still retain her simplicity, her kindness, and her love of humanity, then she has achieved a high level of perfection. Farah Pahlavi is the best thing that could have happened to the Shah and to the people of Iran.
The soul of a nation is to be found not in the big cities with their towering buildings and chaos, but in the villages and in the faces of the simple people who live there. That is probably the reason why Farah Pahlavi loves to visit these villages. In spite of all the wealth brought in by the flow of oil, all is not well in Iran today. There is still poverty, inequality, corruption, and injustice. But there is hope. The Empress has undoubtedly achieved a lot, and the Iranians can today look forward to a better future. The strength of a nation lies not in its material prosperity and the numbers of soldiers and aircraft, but more in the spiritual values that hold it together. Restoring Iran to its spiritual and human values has been Farah Pahlavi's greatest contribution. The Shah and the 33 million Iranians have every reason to be proud of their Shahbanu.